Hey everybody, good afternoon. It's Happy Hour with Dr. Lisa, and I'm your host, Dr. Lisa. Thank you so much for joining me, everybody, especially you guys on social media who are looking at me live. I really appreciate all of you chiming in to hear what I have to say about Volume 28. We are at Blog 18 already, so I've been doing this for 18 weeks already. And this is going to be number two of Twin Flames. Remember, we started Twin Flames last week. So we are going to go into part two of Twin Flames. There's a lot to talk about with these two little kids. If you are confused, make sure you check out the blog. The blog again and again and again is the best way to keep up with what I am discussing on this podcast. So this goes all the way to blog 28, and I'm sorry, blog 19, volume 28 for the podcast. So if you are near a website, you should open up my webpage. It's at lisaligginschambers.com, LISA. LIGGINSCHAMBERS.com. And go down to Twin Flames so you can see these pictures, which look really creepy to me, as we talk about Twin Flames 2. Also, if you want to chime in on Podbean, please do so. You can call into the show. I welcome that. And also, if you have questions, concerns, or you just want to discuss some experiences that you've had, you can email me at kidscanseeghosts@gmail.com. I don't release anyone's name unless you have given me permission to do so. So we can go ahead and get started, but I do want to answer two common questions that I get. One is in reference to psychology. And the other one is in reference to haunted houses. So, big difference, but I'm gonna go ahead and go and answer both of them before we start blog 19, because I'm getting so many people interested in psychology, which is great, asking me questions. So, one of the questions that I commonly respond to is, do I have to have a master's degree prior to applying for a PhD? And that's actually a good question. And a lot of people have asked me that. So I'll tell you what I had. I had a master's degree when I applied for my PhD. And I had a master's degree because I had been a school psychologist already, licensed in Missouri, 4 years before I entertained, actually, 98 to 2001. So 3 years prior to applying for my doctorate, I was already a school psychologist, which does require a master's degree or a specialist degree. Back then, long time ago, we didn't have the specialist degree. Long time ago, you didn't have to go through a lot of what you have to go through now to get licensed as a school psychologist. So I'm old school psychology. And so when I applied for my doctorate, I already had the experience as a master's level school psychologist and also a license to practice school psychology in the state of Missouri. The thing about having a master's degree before you get a doctorate, it's your choice. It's your choice. There are some programs that are joint master's PhD. That is the program that I entered, but I already had a master's degree, so I didn't have to do the master's work, which is great. And it allowed me to also seek approval to get a couple of classes and testing approved so that I didn't have to take them. So, if I recall correctly, there were two courses that I didn't have to take because I already had the testing experience. So, I only had to take personality. Testing, which is really hard. So that's when you get into Rorschachs and your MMPIs and your more difficult categories and what I deem is more difficult in psychology, such as your personality disorders, narcissism, which we keep hearing about in the news, but I'm talking about the clinical type, not the layman's type. So, it just depends. If you apply to a joint program and you're accepted, you can do your master's in that program. And there are a lot of PhD programs like that throughout the country. Or you can, have your master's degree and apply. So really the choice is yours, and it also depends upon the program. So I hope that addressed that common question about should I get a master's degree? I'm all for education. So I'm gonna always tell you to get a master's degree. There's not a lot you can do with a bachelor's degree in psychology or basically the social sciences in general. So that goes to social work, it goes to psychology, and other social sciences. All right, a fun question. It's Halloween almost, and people are going to these haunted houses. So, everybody's asking me a lot of questions about haunted houses. And I want you guys to remember that I cannot, I have never, as far as I can remember, seen ghosts. Keep that in mind when I talk about these podcasts, because I learned two ways. One, from the kids that I work with, who I call nebulous children. I learned from their parents, that's number two. I've learned from some people that are close to me who can see ghosts, but I also learned a lot of different ways to deal with these kids based upon my experiences. So if you go back through the earlier blogs, that will tell you how I learned how to deal with these children. Okay, so I can tell you some things that I know based upon haunted houses from the different kids and their parents that I worked with, and just talking to people over the years. Like some of you actually can see ghosts, and you've talked to me about these things. So here goes. Here's what I know. Okay, we have a spiritual realm. If you are biblical, God does talk about the spiritual realm, okay? Kids and parents who can see ghosts have always told me that they are always around us, okay? So if you think about that, that means that right now where I'm sitting, there are some ghosts in here. And where you're sitting, there are ghosts. I think when people talk about haunted houses, they may be referring to activity that's scary. And that's what it sounds like. Okay, so activity that's scary, and I get that, things appearing, dark shadows. Some people can actually see ghosts and they don't want to admit it too. That's just another topic. So, can houses be haunted? Of course, they can be. Yes, will some things try to get your attention? Of course, they do. I've had those experiences just in dreams, or I don't want to give my blogs away, but. Or blogs in the past couple of weeks, I've talked about things like that, on a more personal level with me. So yeah, to answer your question, yeah, houses can be haunted, but anything can be haunted. Asylums, build other buildings, schools. Remember I talked about kids seeing ghosts at school, or the ghosts were following them on the bus. So anything is possible. It's all about what you believe. And my stories are true. All right. Hope that addresses haunted houses. If you have any more questions, obviously let me know. Let's talk about these two little babies again. We're talking about two children that I met. I went into their backgrounds last week. But if you want to add anything to the story, or you want to talk about it in more detail, hit me on Podbean right now or on these social media sites. So if you look at blog 19, what I tried to do here is to give you a visual of how these kids, both child F and child D, I mean G, not D, G, girl, how they described their experiences to me. So the first picture is actually what they described was in their basement. Well, if you look at the picture, that's exactly what they discussed was in their basement. They kept telling me that there was a demonic portal in their basement over and over and over again. And what that looked like to them was a cave, just a cave, like a bear cave. I want you to imagine this, and I'm sitting here listening to this stuff from these kids, and that it had fire in it. Just like the image on my blog. And so inside of that portal, that's what they called it, or the father called it a portal, was fire, and the demons, again, kids called demons dark angels. They were going in and out of that portal, from the portal to their house, from the house to the portal. And I know some of you are like, oh my God. And that's exactly what it was. But remember, every single time, child G, G for girl, G, talk to me about these experiences, it was It was always a whisper. Okay? And remember, she whispered because she always felt as if what? The dark angels could hear her. So to her, she had to whisper in my office because they were behind the closet doors. And if they heard them talking to me and telling me about what was happening, then when they were home, the demons were going to actually get them and try to take them to the portal. So these were really scared kids. So just to give you a tiny bit of backstory, because some of you are new joining me, these were two children whose father had to be incarcerated for attempted murder of the two children because he wanted to protect them from being captured by the demons and going into this cave. So again, I talked about the difference between mental health and the ability to see ghosts. I'm not going to repeat it here. You guys can read about that stuff in my earlier blogs, but that's what happened. And so typically, when you separate people in a family, let's just say we have an entire family like this, and one parent has challenges with mental health, and then they have children, or they have a wife or a husband, a spouse. And sometimes they all mimic those symptoms, right? When you separate them, it's kind of like a cult. Typically, when you separate people from the cult, their brain goes back to baseline, or what their brains originally, how it functioned, if you will. And so when they're in the house with that person, sometimes they function the way that that person is functioning. So for me, on the mental health side, that's what I was attempting to do when I met these kids, to determine if they truly could see ghosts or if they were mimicking what they've been taught or what they observed. And so I didn't get to go as far as I wanted to with these kids, but these were kids who could actually see ghosts because they had some of the same experiences with me and with their social worker and with a couple of other people that I, just don't want to name at this time. But it was definitely a social worker who they would tell, there's a portal in our basement, there's a demonic portal in our basement, and our father was trying to protect us from this. Now, if you've been following the blogs and the podcast, you know that each kid that I worked with who could see ghosts saw various ghosts around me. The same ones, different cities, different places, different times, all confidential. These two kids saw them too. For example, they saw the angel that's supposed to be guarding me, behind me, and the angel in the tree. Those are my two main angels that when a kid tells me I can see ghosts, I often will look at them and wait for them to tell me about those two. So these kids did that. So there was a sense of these truly were nebulous children, but they may have had some transfer of mental illness. Does that make sense? I hope that makes sense to all of you. Okay, so when you look at that portal on my page, that's how it looks. Now, if you're not looking at the page, you have to imagine the cave with fire in it. And I want you to add a demon to it. So add dark angels. So the second picture is showing you what these kids told me going in and out of the portal. Now, these dark angels aren't always scary. Remember that. Satan was a fallen angel. He was beautiful. according to biblical scriptures, right? So not all angels are scary. Some of you are putting up scary emojis. Imagine how I felt. And these kids were like, there was a portal in the basement. Like, oh my God, this is a horror film. But anyway, they were, you know, the cutest little kids. And so add these dark angels to it, okay? And that their father told them that these things could capture them. Now, I don't know about all of you, but if I was a kid, and this is what my parent told me, I would have been scared. Let me tell you a story my mother told me, just to give you an example. She's going to kill me. She's watching me on Facebook. Hi, Mom. I guess when I was in middle school, my grandfather passed away. And so my mom, when you would go into, so instead of finished basements back then, we had finished attics, right? So we had this nice finished attic. When my grandfather passed away, all of his furniture was shipped to Cleveland, which is where I'm from, and my mother had it in our attic. And so when you would go up there, you could smell my grandfather's cologne. And I remember this, mother, you can smell my grandfather's cologne. And my mother's so silly, she would say, oh, he's probably up there. Who says that to a kid? She would always say, oh, he's probably up there just protecting us. That's why you smell his cologne. But my mom is silly, so she would tell me some crap like that. So I was scared. And I stopped going up in the attic because I was like, I just smell his cologne. It's a ghost up here. My grandfather's probably up here. So imagine if I really could see ghosts, or imagine if you can see them like these kids, and in your house, you're seeing these things that their father's telling them is coming out of this portal. So these kids would tell me stuff like, it was in the kitchen, it was following me. When I'm sleeping, it's at the foot of my bed. Dark angels come out, they spread their wings. I'm scared. They're going to get me. They're going to take me. I thought my own grandfather was coming to get me because I could smell him in the attic. So imagine how these little babies felt, you know, imagine listening to their parent who's supposed to be protecting them, which he was in his own twisted way. And was warning them about these demons. So every time these kids were taken from their home, and they were glad because they were always frightened in their home. And so I actually got a little nervous with these two. And I'll tell you why. Because they were constantly protective of the closet in my office. And they were constantly telling me they are in there. So I decided at that point never to open up the closets in my office. It was just like in my brain, there was some dark ghost in there, although I had prayed about over the office because I had to, you know. And then I talked about this too. I had a boss back then who would grab my hands and pray because we had a lot of activity, a lot of paranormal activity in the building. And these kids kept telling me about it. And these were two who kept telling me about it. So we decided, I mentioned to you guys before, I think, that we were going to go ahead and finish the building. Anyway, we had, you know, the kids said that they couldn't come into the office because the office was protected. So they felt safe in the office and they could go ahead and talk about what was happening. But they had to whisper all the time. So somebody just asked what happened to their mother. Their mother was not in the picture. She was not in the picture. They were being, and the reason she wasn't in the picture is because she was incarcerated too. So they were being raised by their dad, who was now incarcerated. And actually, and I didn't write this in the blog, these two actually said their mother could see ghosts too, but I can't verify that. The whispering is giving me chills. Yeah. You think? And then remember the child, F, was guarding, always guarding against these dark angels coming out. The reason that I'm also showing you guys these pictures on the blog is because when these, I'm going to call them dark angels because that's what all the kids call them. The adult term, obviously, is demons. When all of this is happening, these dark angels were also talking to these kids. Can you hear me? We're coming to get you. We have your father. And they did not feel like they had a way out, even though they were taken from the home. So this was extremely distressing to these kids. And this is why I say, if you come across a kid like this, don't discount their stories. Actually listen to them to gain a full picture as to what's happening with these kids. So when they were removed from their home, the third picture shows you these two kids. This was the best picture I can find. These two kids, and that these dark angels were constantly around them, talking to them, attacking them, touching them, which is why I have them touching in the picture on the blog, the blog on my website. When they lost their father, they lost a sense of control over what was happening in the home. Does that make sense? So the father was the one who was keeping them protected from being taken into the portal. Without their father, these things were constantly bugging these kids, and the kids interpreted it as they were going to take them into picture one, the portal. So what do you do? Just pause right there. What do you do when you get kids like this, when you are a psychologist or a counselor or a social worker? It's hard. It's hard. And you never say that working with these kind of kids or working with kids in general is easy. But this is a whole different level. This is, we had an attempted murder. We had kids being taken away from their home. We had a father who is now gone, who is raising the kids. He's incarcerated. He could see ghosts. These kids can see ghosts. These kids are frightened constantly. And then we had me, and we had a social worker who didn't believe them. So this was a hell of a dynamic, wasn't it? And the only thing that I could do, shout out to all my fist guides. The only thing that I can do is to try to tease through the puzzle to figure out what was happening. And so, because Child G was the talkative one, and mind you, constantly whispering and basically sitting on my lap, she was the one who seemed to feel the significant loss. She was the one who would whisper, which is why, if you look at the website, this child had big blue eyes like this. Okay? This is a kid who was very talkative and actually told me things about their home being haunted, speaking of haunted houses, and talked to me about how, these dark angels whisper to them that they're going to take them away, they're going to take them in the basement, that the father was taken away, and they're going to take them now that they don't have the dad. I mean, these demons were just really messing with these kids, except when they would come in my office because, again, they said that, the office was prayed over, so, they could not enter my office, which is true. Okay? So when you are a psychologist, this is a heavy case. And I actually got, I think, my director, who was the one that prayed over the building because we had so many paranormal disturbances in the building. These kids also saw the little spirit boy, by the way. So this building, we cleansed it in prayer This is why this kid or both of these kids discussed feeling safe in the building, but they constantly said, "We don't want the demons to get us. We don't want the demons to get us or to get them." So, what do you do? There's a therapist that chimed in and said, "Listen to really?" She said, "Listen to me." So she can learn how to deal with these kids, basically. Clients, patients, students, you're so silly. You gotta learn how to deal with this stuff on your own, too. So every time I would get a difficult case, and to this day, I just actually got a difficult case that I'm finishing up. And it's, you always have to study. But in this case, it was my duty to get someone else on board with me. And that's what I had to do. You can handle this on your own, by all means, but I'm never ever too educated to ask for help. And in this case, I got help because there were so many not dynamics, not to mention these kids actually made me nervous. And I've told some of my family members and even some of my colleagues a long time ago when I had these kids, that these are probably the scariest kids, nebulous kids that I've ever dealt with. It wasn't just the whispering. Imagine if you were sitting in the office and they're telling you that it's some stuff behind your closet. And mind you, I didn't open up the closet. I had too many kids talked about that closet. So I made an executive Dr. Lisa decision never to open that closet. I actually did open it later on. And I'll tell you what was in it. However, at that point, I was like, yeah, I'm not opening that closet. So when she would whisper different things to me in my ear, that was what I was going to say. It was in my ear. So it wasn't in my face. She wasn't sitting next to me. She was always like, shh. Even when I would speak loudly, she would say, shh. They can hear you. The demons can hear you. The dark angels can hear you. Shh. And I would kind of go, what do you mean? And shh, they were always behind the door. That was me talking, not her. And so it was probably one of the scariest times that I worked with kids, but it was also a huge learning experience, as I discussed at the end of blog, I believe it's 20. And because we have some time with these two kids, I'm going to talk about them a little bit, in a little bit more detail. So after I wrote this blog, I really started thinking, do you remember the movie The Sixth Sense? You guys remember that movie where the little boy was saying, "I see people." That was my experience with these kids. And that quote comes up often when, that movie is discussed, because to most people, saying to in a movie, "I see dead people," that actually resonates as probably a really scary statement. And so that's how these two kids were toward me, and it was just creepy. And it takes a lot to creep me out with paranormal activity, because I've been dealing with it for so long, if you will, especially with kids. So it takes a lot. But at that point, the way that it was happening was scary. And let's talk about the little boy, child G, F, and G. So child F, okay, kept his distance. You know how you think of somebody having an old soul? That's how this little boy was. And kept his distance because he really felt the need to guard us against these dark angels that were surrounding to him, my office, particularly in the closet. And so he did talk to me and tell me these things happen, but not as much as his sister. Because his job was to guard, and remember, their father was gone, so he really felt a sense or a need to guard. And so as she would speak in my left ear, he would be talking to me in the middle of the floor, going back and forth like this with his head, moving his head from me to the door, because he wanted to make sure those demons weren't coming out of the door. These kids also saw the little ghost boy that I talk about in future blogs from this particular blog that I'm discussing. So they saw that in the building. So when I tell you there was just in this building, speaking of haunted houses, haunted office buildings, there was a lot of paranormal activity in building two and three. I didn't get as much in building one, but I did get nebulous kids. But building two was very scary to kids. So, when they discussed the family's ability to see ghosts, it was very concrete. It was very, it was not their imagination. It was not their imagination. It was, they told a story from beginning to end. And they discussed the things that other kids saw in the building. So, do you understand that? So, a lot of the kids, for example, would see the little ghost boy running through the building. These kids would come in the door like, "There he is!" before I even talked to them about the little ghost boy. Or they would just kind of look at me, especially a little boy, and look up behind me like this. That makes my alarms go off because all the kids that could see ghosts that I work with will often do that behind me. Or tell me something like, "Did you know there was an angel behind you?" Stuff like that. So these kids did that. And so they told me a couple stories about nighttime. So it's October. So I'm going to tell you what they would tell me. They said at night, dark angels were more active. During the day, they would say their father, of course, would protect them. This was before they were removed from him when he was incarcerated. That their father would protect them during the day, or they would be at school, but at night, when they would get home, they would see these things, and at night, they were more active. It's actually really sad because I did believe the father. I believe the father. I believe. And I do believe because what he did was he took it to a level of he allowed it to take him to a level of being mentally ill. And so I had a lot of empathy for him, but man, I was scared for those kids, and I'm glad they were taken away, from him. And he couldn't be near them at all, which it was really sad though, because these were also really sad kids, understandably. But they were actually in danger. And people ask me about demons all the time. What do I always tell you guys? That's another common question. Can I play with a Ouija board? Can I do this? How do I summon demons? This is why you don't summon them. They're not your friends. Stop pretending that they are. Demons hate humans. They will hurt us. They hurt us all the time. Just look at what's happening in the news. So stay away from them. So he let it get to a level where, he lost his spirituality. He lost his relationship with God. And I always tell you guys, it doesn't matter if you believe in God or not. God is who restores these people back to baseline. So my immediate guess was that these kids could see ghosts. Okay? They are seeing the same stuff in the building. Every detail was the same, and they were consistent with it. And every time they would come in the building, they would talk about this little spirit boy over and over again. Okay? The big difference between the two kids is that this little girl was more frightened than the little boy. She was a lot more frightened. She was very, trying to give you a visual of her. You ever had a little kid who just, other than your kids, who just wouldn't leave your side? I had a little boy like that today, who just won't leave your side. Is constantly clinging to you. That's how she was attaching to me, and she was attaching to other people like that. And she would tell you, "I don't want I don't want that to get me. or I don't want them to take me to. They did not, you know how I tell you sometimes with little kids, you have to tell them that they can't tell everybody that they have this ability. These kids told everybody. Anybody who would listen, I can't go home. I can't do this. They're gonna get me. Stuff like that. So they would tell everybody. And they would even tell me, for example, when they saw the angel in the tree, he's laughing, but he said that we shouldn't be scared when we're with you. Stuff like that. So the craziest thing to me is when the kids would get quiet and they would actually go over to the closet. So there were two closets, and there was this wall space in the middle. So these two closets, sometimes the kids would get up and they would actually go closer to the closets and they would say they're talking. They're talking. Dr. Lisa, shh, because I can hear them talking. And they were trying to figure out if the demons were planning or how they were planning to take them. So imagine now I'm sitting there and they're at the closets and I'm like, guys, come back over and talk to me. And they're like, shh. They're in the closet. That's some scary stuff. So I have to tell you, one day when they left, I was like, I'm not a chicken. I'm opening up these closets. I'm gonna see what's in the closet. I'm gonna see because I'm not scared of this stuff. And so I was like, okay, I can do this because I gotta, figure out what I need to do to make these kids safe because I thought that I was gonna have a really long relationship with these kids. And so I opened up the closets because, again, let me just clarify. These were not the first kids to tell me to stay away from the closet. These were not the first kids to tell me that. So I stayed away from them because remember when I didn't listen before and I was going into building three, I actually came back out of building three and was pushed down the steps. Remember I said that? When I had plenty of warnings from kids, don't go into building three. And I went anyway. This time I was like, I'm not pregnant. I'm getting ready to open up these closets. I'm not afraid of this stuff. So I went up to the closets and I opened them. And there was nothing in there that I could see. But what they were, I don't know what they call them like in the early 1900s, but I can describe them. And if you think about it, Victorian building, this could be a little scary. Why do I want to say dummy waiters? You guys can correct me. Where you could take down food in them and they go all the way down. It reminds you, this is an old Victorian, so it's huge. So that dummy waiters, is that the name? Where they were putting food on it and pulling them up and pulling them down. And that's what these things were when you open up the closet. So I decided I was just going to open them and leave them open. And just get it out of my chest, all of the anxiety that these kids and other kids have given me about these closets. And here's a sidebar. I kid you not. I saw child B and her mother. And they walked into my office and said, "You open the closet." And I didn't even tell them. And I was like, God, these kids know everything and their parents. And I said, well, I remember that day because it was raining. And I said, how did you know? And she said, the atmosphere changed. You should keep them closed. I said, no, I'm going to pray over those closets. And this is going to change because there's too many kids getting afraid of, in my office about these closets. Child B, remember Child B from earlier blogs? And her mother told me, as soon as they walked in the door, there's a door over there, that's what I'm pointing. You opened up the closet. Let me tell you something. They weren't real closets. These were fake closets. I guess under construction, they may have put doors on them, but I think that's what it was. You can roll the food up and down. But after Child B came in there and said that, I prayed and closed those closets. And guess what never happened again? I never opened them again. I was like, screw that. Then I started thinking about should I resign or not? Because too many of my kids were having anxiety. But before I came to the anxiety about the paranormal activity in that building, but before I came to that conclusion, I continued to work with these two kids. And these kids knew I opened up the closet too. I'm like, what the heck did I do? Opening up the closets to where, I'm not telling these kids, like these people are not my friends. They're my clients. And that's how I treated them, although we had very good rapport. So I didn't say to them, hey, I opened up the closet and let all the demons fly in. I didn't say that. They would actually come into the door and stop and look at me and look. The door was like here and the closets were over here. And they would come into the door and stop and kind of go, you opened up the closets. And the doors were closed. Remember I said I closed them. So these kids did that too. And these kids were a little different, which was interesting because they Child F didn't whisper anymore. So I opened up the closets. They all knew I opened up the closets, but Child G didn't feel the need to whisper any longer. Amazing. They're gone. You tell me prayer doesn't work to help this stuff, because it does. So the thing is, these kids would also stare out the window and talk to the angel in the tree. I have so many stories about these two kids. And the angel, and that angel, is my angel, according to all the kids, would talk to these kids. Now, I want you to picture this. So remember, I said you walk in the door. To the right is my desk. The windows, the closets are here as you walk in the door. The windows are on the wall to the right. These kids would make a beeline to the windows, to the left one, and just stare out the window like this, if you can see me, like they're listening to what's being said to them. So, according to them, the angel in the tree had talked to them about what was in the closet, told them not to talk to what was in the closet. But here's the thing, what was these dark angels were also telling these kids not to talk to me and not to talk to the angel in the tree. It was so heavy and deep. Child F, the little boy, obeyed what was told to him from the angel. Child B got a little bit oppositional because the dark angels were telling both of them not to talk to the angel in the tree and not to talk to me. But now they started staring at the walls too. So when I pause sometimes, I'm picturing everything in my head as I remember it, because there's so much, and I'm glancing back and forth at the blog. They would also stare at the walls, because now when they would look at the walls, they could hear what's being said in the walls. So this was just ongoing and non-stop. So what am I supposed to do about the walls? So it was a constant, I'm looking at the walls in my basement. There is a constant battle that I was dealing with these kids. It seemed like whatever I did to the closet by opening and praying or whatever, that helped. But then they moved to the walls, and it was just so much that even when they would go into the waiting room, The waiting room was a former living room or family room, had a fireplace. These kids, I didn't even write this in the blog, these kids were also kind of like go up to the fireplace and look up, like, oh God, they're talking in the fireplace, or the toys would go off. It was a lot. It was a lot. My coworkers knew about it as well, and so did my director. So when these things happened, I didn't keep quiet about it. I would always talk to people about it, because none of us are trained to deal with this stuff. We don't learn this in school. So we had to figure out how to deal with this kind of stuff. So now they were talking in the walls. They could hear them. They were like, "They're over there. They're over there." And you could see the little boy was just kind of looking around at the walls, like, what are they doing? You know, why are they're moving around the walls? What are we gonna do about it?" And I'm like, "I don't know." But I kept a Bible in my office and had to, one thing I had to do was to pray before those kids came in. Because honestly, you know what? I'm gonna be honest with you. You start kind of wondering if you are dealing with the possession because it was just so much. And the dad may have been possessed. I'm not sure, but I will say that this was probably the most I've ever experienced, even to this day, with kids who were constantly plagued with no control because no one taught them over what they're seeing. And it kept happening, and it kept happening around me. Even if I would walk outside with these kids, they were like so close to me and so nervous and just paranoid that these things were going to get them when they would get home. So my job was to help them. And I had their social worker on the other end constantly referring to these kids being, quote, crazy, and that I wasn't addressing their craziness. So before I end right there, when you have kids like this, one of the things that you don't do when they're under your care is to move quickly with them. It's almost like when they started telling me this cycle of trauma that they've had, not to mention the ability to see ghosts. They were removed from home. Their father was gone. Their mother was gone. They're in state custody. It's like, I'm sorry, you want to move how fast because you think they're crazy? And she wanted these kids on medication management. She wanted these kids on antipsychotics. And they were delusional to her. I disagreed, held my position, and they were not placed on medication. Hello, and they were not diagnosed with a delusional disorder. And they were to continue therapy per court order for as long as I needed them to be there. Although they were eventually taken away, but I dealt with them for quite a while. It seemed as if the case manager wanted a quick fix for these kids, but not a solution. And that is where I'm going to stop because I am going to address that from a psychological perspective next week. That quick fix and not a solution. And to this day, it drives me insane on my students. Want to get a quick fix on clients and not try to determine the root of the problem. So I really appreciate you all joining me today. I will be back next week and we will continue to talk about these two kids. And then we will probably be able to get into blog. Which one is the blog 21? And I titled it after Will Smith's song, Parents, or his rap, Parents just don't understand. And so when you get a chance, go ahead and read the blog so you can catch up. And I want to tell you, on blog 20, I actually started that one with someone who sent me a long message to thank me for telling these kids' stories. Again, I promised one kid in particular, and then along my journey with these kids, a couple of others, that I would eventually talk about some of their stories to get it out in the public. And this person said, "I'm one of the children that you write about, Dr. Lisa. Thank you." And that's the reason I do it. So I'll catch you all next week. Have a wonderful up and coming weekend. Bye.